Watch us on YouTube and Facebook. Listen to our podcast and support us on Patreon. Thanks for stopping by.
The early history of astrology is closely interrelated with astronomy. Both may be studied separately, but the result may prove one-sided, and one may fail to notice things of great consequence. The history of ancient astronomy must be treated jointly with the history of astrology, whose contribution to the history of science has often been underestimated. This situation has begun to change only recently. The term astrology Astrologe, a science of stars or study of stars that derives from ancient Greek, and is made up of two words, centesti, aristeia, star, or constellation, and an intricate form logoi, logos, that may denote very different things, reasoning, intellect, story, word, etc., that we, perhaps, may here translate as a study. Although the names of several modern sciences such as philology, geology, and biology end with the same combining form, we cannot consider astrology as the science of stars, which in fact is the general definition of astronomy. The term astronomy is formed with the word nomage and nomos, or law, thus the direct translation of astronomy is the law of stars. Before the Middle Ages, the word astrology was often used to designate the science of stars. Sometimes the above terms were used synonymously. The modern definition of astrology describes it as a discipline that characterizes and foretells things and events according to the configuration of celestial bodies, and presently does not include it among sciences proper. Therefore, to avoid confusion, in the following we will use the terms astrology and astronomy in the modern sense, even though they may conflict in form with source texts. Instead of our term astrologi tetrabiblos by Claudius Ptolemy uses the expression to de centranum aj prognostican, prognostication through astronomy, whereas both centranema and centrologa denote astronomy. The outlines of Western astrology already materialized in ancient times, with the Greek background and Egyptian traditions playing an important role. Most of it, however, developed in Hellenic Egypt and Rome. Early Roman astrology is first and foremost associated with Marcus Manilius the Hub and Dorotheos Iniculum, the later period with Vettius Valens, and the final period with Firmicus Maternus. Hubert Korsch has summarized the known connections of prominent figures of antiquity with astrology. In its final form, ancient astrology is a product of the Hellenic era. It was affected by different cultures, since the conquests of the Macedonians induced an active cultural exchange between the regions of Mesopotamia, Egypt, Greece, and Iran. All authors have agreed that while other cultures have merely supplemented it, the main principles, ideology, and basic methods of astrology still originate in Mesopotamia, although its contribution to the doctrine that had developed by the end of antiquity has often been underestimated. According to Ptolemy, the astrologer must be a man that knows accurately the movements of all the stars, the sun, and the moon, so that neither the place nor the time of any of their configurations. Ptolemy uses the notion centesti rwn, stars, to designate planets rather than fixed stars. The astrologer's work can be roughly divided into two parts. First, the astrologer needs to gather the astronomic material relevant to the task, foretelling the country's future, calculating birth or congruity horoscopes. Then he must interpret material, and only the interpreted and commented product will become astrological. The main astronomical components of astrology are astrological planets, signs of the zodiac, and astrological houses, which have all developed and changed in the course of time. Information on the development of all the main astrological components, except for the system of houses, which is of more recent origin, is described in Mesopotamian texts. The early history of astrology was therefore written primarily in Mesopotamia. Astrology was by no means the only method of prediction in Mesopotamia, where the art of foretelling, often interrelated with healing magic, was regarded very favorably. The future was read from the condition of animal livers, by considering eclipses, from atmospheric phenomena, the migration of birds, etc. In this sense, the culture located between the Tigris and Euphrates was not unique. Using livers and bird migration for foretelling the future was also characteristic of the Etruscans and the Romans. Astrology, however, has at least three important advantages over all other arts of prediction: the divine nature of stars, the universality of celestial phenomena, and the fact that these phenomena could be forecasted. Similarly to the history of Mesopotamian astronomy, that can be divided into three distinctive periods, Mesopotamian astrology also passed through three periods of development: i.e. early or augury astrology, primitive zodiacal astrology, and horoscopic astrology. As the history of Mesopotamia is very long and complex, it is important to know the specific period or location on which the statement is based, otherwise it is easy to come to wrong conclusions. If we make generalizations over the whole history of Mesopotamia, it would be virtually impossible to analyze, say, the names of planets. A prophecy written on the 2nd millennium BC says, "If a child were born on the 12th month, it would live long and bear many children." Although the prophecy shares a striking similarity to the daily horoscopes published in today's newspapers, it is still an example of primitive prediction rather than astrology proper. In the course of time, astrology transcended all other methods of prediction. Due to the old Babylonian astral religion, the universality of celestial pichinamina as omens, and the ability to forecast, the system of astrological houses and zodiac symbols does not originate in Babylonia, although in the period of horoscopic astrology certain divisions of the ecliptic signs of the zodiac gradually began to replace constellations. Whether it was inspired by Egyptian influence or devised by the Chaldeans themselves is still uncertain. Early astrology was practiced in the Assyro-Babylonian or Akkadian period of astral religion. From this period we know the extant omen series called Enuma Anu Enlil, the original version of which is dated to the 2nd millennium BC, although it was also practiced under the rule of King Ashurbanipal. In early astrology, predictions were made through different omens. Observing eclipses was of great importance. In the Assyrian era, eclipses could already be forecasted. Numerous tablets of Assyrian astrologers' reports to the king, containing a thorough description of the observation and planets seen during the eclipse, and how the obscuration shifted, have been preserved to the present day. Areas of the moon were associated with geographical locations, which meant that it may have been possible to attribute the misfortune predicted by the eclipse to the neighboring country instead. On the 14th day the moon will make an eclipse. It predicts evil for Elam and the Westland, good for the king my lord. Let the king my lord be happy. In Adar 12 on the 14th day the moon will make an eclipse. If the moon makes an eclipse in Adar, a 12th on the 14th day in the evening watch, it gives its decision for the king of the world, for your, and the Westland. If the moon will make an eclipse in Adar, a 12th the king of Elam will die. Next to the weather, cloudlessness, and wind, it was also important to consider the alignment and relative movement of planets during the eclipse. If Jupiter stands inside the moon, in this year the king will die, there will be an eclipse of the moon and sun, a great king will die. If Jupiter enters the moon, there will be famine in the Westland, the king of Elam will fall in battle, in Sabatu, a noble will revolt against his lord. Analogous prediction to the court and the king was also practiced in the late Babylonian period, though in this period new tendencies began to emerge. The conviction that earthly occurrences were the aftermath of celestial phenomena was widespread. Primitive zodiacal astrology developed in the state of Chaldea, or late Babylonia, that emerged after the destruction of Assyria by the Babylonians in alliance with the Medes. The impact of Zervanism, the predecessor of contemporary Iranian religions, the cult of Mitra, and Zoroastrianism on Babylonia was immense. Stars function as indicators. When the stars assume their original position at the end of the great year, all events to the smallest detail will recur. This doctrine has also been called astral fatalism. Even Greek philosophy contains traces of this doctrine. Pythagoras has argued that everything that has ever happened will recur at a predetermined time in the future, and is not utterly new. According to the Stoic philosophy, the world will be destroyed by fire, when all planets have returned to their original position, and a new world will emerge. In his book Anthropologia Nemesios Emesinos, the clerical figure and philosopher in the early Byzantine Empire, claimed that as long as stars follow their usual course, everything will recur exactly as it happened, even in the smallest detail. Heraclitus believed that the great year lasted for 18,000 years, whereas the Stoics, as Simplicios has written, considered it 360 times longer. He who has seen present things has seen all, both everything which has taken place from all eternity, and everything which will be for time without end, for all things are of one kin and of one form. It is extremely important to bear in mind that according to this idea, the stars are not the cause of events. Their movement is something like the movement of the hands of a clock, which indicate the time when a given event will occur, but do not cause the event. The relation between cause and effect is universal and irrevocable. The astronomic text Mulepin describes constellations on the moon's path, the gods that stand on his way, and whose territory the moon passes every month. The list of 18 such constellations is proof that actual constellations, not zodiac signs, were meant. Later, when zodiac astrology came into use, the ecliptic was divided that included the constellation of the same name, or at least part of it. Foretelling was based on the movement of the moon and the planets relative to zodiac signs. Although in texts, astrological constellation and zodiac sign names were sometimes used simultaneously, a saying at the beginning of the Nisan month Jupiter and Venus are at the beginning of Gemini can only be interpreted astrologically. For example, the size of the crop harvest was predicted by the moon's position relative to a zodiac sign on the day of Sirius's heliacal rise. Since the sun moves counterclockwise relative to the stars, a star on the day of its heliacal rise is visible for a moment just before dawn. The heliacal rise of Sirius was used in Egypt to predict the beginning of the Nile's flooding. This example seems to support the opinion that dividing the ecliptic into sections of equal length may be a result of Egyptian influence. Assyria's conquest of Egypt brought these big cultures into direct contact. There were also strong ties between Chaldea and Egypt, although relations were not always friendly. In Egypt, however, the ecliptic was divided into 36 segments, each holding the sun for 10 days. Three segments made up one lunar month, and also 1/12 of the ecliptic. Zodiacal astrology demanded much more of astronomy than predicting astrology had. This was the beginning of diligent moon watching and elaboration of the cycles of the planets. Knowledge emerged that could be used to indirectly calculate the position of the planets and the moon. This came in handy later in compiling birth horoscopes, since a child could also be born during the day or on a cloudy night. Horoscopic astrology appeared in Mesopotamia during the Pashan occupation. At that time, Mazdaism was predominant in Iran. According to Mazdaism, the world was created by the highest of the gods, the personification of goodness, and light Ahura Mazda. The personification of darkness and evil Angra Mainyu or Ahriman causes trouble in the world of humans, but will eventually be defeated. Persian influence can also be observed in the works of Greek Aethals. In the sky there are Zeus and 11 main gods on war chariots, with them a heavenly army of gods and demons followed by the souls of people preaching to them. The souls that fall down will in their earthly life follow the same gods as they did in heaven. This indicates that the position of the planets at a child's birth determines the qualities of the soul that settles in the child's body. There seems to have been a quite practical reason for the beginning of the making of birth horoscopes, since the Persian conquerors had no need of the services of the Babylonian astrologists. The astrologists had to find another way to earn a living. The Babylonian birth horoscope predicts a child's future and character, and the course of their life from the positions of planets at the moment of birth. This was actually usually based on the moment of the beginning of sunset of the day preceding birth, since Babylonians, as many other peoples using the lunar calendar, counted the start of a day from sunset. Later, time of birth was determined within a quarter of a day, or 6 hours. The best-known old horoscope describes the sky on April 29, 410 BC. The text is translated as follows. Nisanu, knight of the 14th, son of Umuyuza, Umuadina, descendant, was born. At that time the moon was below the pincer of the scorpion, Jupiter in Pisces, Venus in Taurus, Saturn in Cancer, Mars in Gemini. Predictions tend to be general, mainly concerning character, and concrete predictions were avoided. Early horoscopes also include pseudo-horoscopic predictions mainly in connection with eclipses. If a child is born and during his infancy a solar eclipse occurs, he will die in a foreign city, and the house of his father will be scattered. As a rule, horoscopic predictions are positive. If it is predicted that a child will not become rich, a way is still found to bring becoming rich into the prediction. In time, the positions of planets became increasingly important, and they were marked more precisely relative to the zodiac. In a horoscope from 235 BC, the positions of all planets are marked in relation to the zodiac to an accuracy of 1 degree. Planets were the most powerful element in Babylonian astrology. Horoscopes also considered the relative positions of the planets, especially their relation with the sun. What in Hellenic times was the teaching about the domination and exile of planets probably started out as the Babylonian concept of a planet's secret home, the zodiac sign in which a planet is located, giving it additional influence. In Chaldean horoscopes, the formation of the essential elements of astrology, except the system of houses and the importance of the sign, which both are of later origin, can be observed well. It is true that astrology has a long history, but there is no proof in the history of Mesopotamian astrology to back up the assertions that the effects of the signs and planets were discovered during long-term observations. Instead, one can observe the combination and adjustment of birth horoscopes according to the needs of the time. A flexible interpretation develops first, and only then the rules and framework for composing a horoscope are formed. Even though astrology developed during the Hellenic period, its ideology was already formed during the Mesopotamian period. Later development was rather a refinement of details. Apparently, there is no reason to doubt that the modern pseudoscience of the same name is based on its antique predecessor. Many borrowed their method from astrology, For example, many horoscopes were compiled that were not based on the starry sky, numerology developed, telling fortunes by cards, etc. In the first step, all these disciplines use techniques that can be compared to computational or data gathering and processing techniques, and which are claimed to be scientific. In the next step, the product will be interpreted prognostically, using more or less inflexible algorithms. The manner of interpreting also plays an important role. This makes ancient astrology one of the main roots elements of scientific thinking in ancient Greek philosophy, astronomy, and cosmology. We may notice the process of mythic thinking changing in ancient Greece. The fall of the mythic world can be seen in epics. Homer uses comparison, which is not a mythic, but already a poetical method. The way Homer describes the deeds of the gods, their quarrels, their amorous adventures, Homer does not raise the question of how the world came into being. Hesiod, who started systemizing gods, and Hesiod Anaximander, Anaximenes Chaos Archi, a primary substance, air. Eros separation of cold and warm thickening, and thinning earth, Agaia, and Tartaros earth, and air earth, and air. Night and day, the sphere of fire sky Uranos, from Gaia celestial bodies, from earth the mountains, seas, ocean sea, from ocean sea. Myths, by describing the beginning of the world in his Theogony, does that. With this, the basis of the mythic world was torn apart. Hesiod's gods are connected with each other, and have somehow come into being, and have developed. His gods are personalized forces, elements of nature, and have emerged due to some historical process. In the beginning there is chaos, which is not the absolute antithesis of order, the meaning of the word as it is used in contemporary mathematics. Comparing the understanding of Hesiod and that of the Ionic philosophers about how the world came into being, one can see that these conceptions are very similar. The elements can be compared on a one-to-one basis. Hesiod takes a long step towards the philosophical way of thinking. Thales of Miletus was the first to give up the mythic interpretation of the world for the philosophic one. According to him, the source of being is in reality itself, nature, not in something supernatural, something outside nature. Water is the beginning of everything, endless matter, which is in eternal movement. Everything can be formed and destroyed, but the primary substance is stable and eternal. Anaximander of Miletus did not consider any element to be primary. His primary substance is an abstract original matter, which is endless, indefinite, euanpeiron vapeiron. It will be a serious mistake to take it for some primary material, of which everything is put together, as the modern man accepts and understands it. The word euanpeiroge in Greek means boundless, endless, infinite, countless, etc. Secondary meaning is inexperienced, incompetent, profane. This word is in opposition to the word tapiraj, which means a limit, bound, edge, border, end, etc. In his cosmology, Anaximander contrasts definable with indefinable. For the Greeks, tapiraj was something they could understand. The word had a positive meaning compared to euanpeiron, which was something that was not understandable, that was awful and negative. Euanpeiron is the place where everything that exists resides, being at the same time an opposite to itself. It is by this that the transition from being something to negation of the same takes place, for example from cold to hot. According to Anaximander, things do not form from the qualitative change of an element but due to the separation of the opposites, which is caused by eternal movement. We do not know if it is possible to interpret euanpeiron as a matter, if it is spatial, if it is mathematically infinite, but we do know that it is the indefinable, indeterminable that surrounds us. The existing can exist by being tapiraj, but its beginning and end is euanpeiron. The philosophy of Pythagoras is based on the concept of numbers as an ideal object. There is not much known about his cosmogony, something might have preserved through Philolaus. It may be that the idea of a spherical earth and heavenly bodies comes from Pythagoras. More important is his teaching of soul, which has been influenced by the religion of Iran and Mesopotamia, and through which the ideology that favored the astrological way of thinking started to spread in Greek culture. Heraclitus of Ephesus considers fire as the primary substance. From fire there will come water, earth, air and fire again. Fire is changing, the world is changing, and there is nothing stable in it. The idea that the earth rotates, and the principle of the temporal infinitude of the universe originate from Heraclitus. It is definitely known that Parmenides of Elea considered the earth spherical. He was the first to discover that the morning star and the evening star were the same. Parmenides' difference between reason and mind pointed out the distinction between truth and opinion. According to his main point of view, there is only one eternal existence, identical with itself, changeless, invariable, stationary, constant. Reality is a single, so thought also his student Zeno of Elea. The common sense belief in the existence of the many, or in motion, also leads to paradoxes. It is interesting to note that logical consequences are for Parmenides, and for Zeno more important than empirical facts. Plato's cosmology is interesting, and complicated, but very mythical too. The same cosmological model is described in Dialogues Republic and Timaeus. The world consists of 8 concentric spheres on the same shaft, and they all rotate with different velocities. The outer sphere is for fixed stars and others for planets. The Earth lies at the center of the spheres. From Earth, all the spheres seem to be one common surface. In Timaeus, we find the same model connected to the soul of the world. The material of soul is mixed and given the appropriate mathematical structure using different movements of stars and planets. The outer sphere for fixed stars is the circle of the same. The others, for the planets, are in the circle of different. A human's ability to see similarities means that his soul is in rotation synchronized with the same rotation of the soul of the world. Therefore, a human's ability to see differences means that his soul is in rotation synchronized with the different rotation of the soul of the world. In both dialogues, reasons for the movements of spheres are described. There are 3 fates, daughters of necessity, Lachesis, Clotho and Atropos. Clotho, things of present, helps turn the sphere of the same. Atropos, are things to come, helps turn the spheres of the different, but they all rotate much slower, like the outer sphere. Lachesis, are things of past, causes retrograde movement of planets. Different speeds of planets far from the Sun and close to the Sun is explicable by weakening of impetus. According to Plato, our world is unique, and the sphere of fixed stars is its boundary. If all things exist inside the boundary, may we ask, what is outside? Later, this was used as a place for the other world. In the medieval period, it was quite a popular idea to put paradise outside the sphere of fixed stars. Such a point of view splits the universe into 2 different regions. Plato's model corresponded to observational astronomy in his time, but only qualitatively. More important was its philosophical and mythical subject. Eudoxus of Cnidus discarded mythical explanations and used only geometrical arguments for the movement of planets. This is the real beginning of scientific astronomy. To explain retrograde movement, he used a set of interconnected spheres. In spite of several problems, it was an important result of theoretical thinking. Aristotle used Eudoxus as model of the universe, but he needed 55 spheres in order to account for current astronomical observations. The movement of planets is easily explicable by the Aristotelian theory of five elements. Four of the elements are terrestrial or sublunar. Two of them, fire and earth, are light. Their natural tendency is to flee away from the center of the universe, and they move upward. Two terrestrial elements, earth and water, are heavy. Their natural tendency is to fall down, as near as possible to the center of the universe. But from the moon sphere outwards, the universe consists of the fifth element, whose natural motion is circular. This whole explanation is elegant, but then we must abandon the principle of the unity of all substances in the universe. In spite of that, astronomy as scientific discipline can be considered as the most important result of Eudoxus's and Aristotelian works. The development of scientific astronomy can be treated as working on details, but the method has roughly remained the same. To observe, to fit the results in demythologized theory, and later on to check the theory against observations. The influence of astrology in ancient Greece on scientific thinking. Mesopotamia has influenced Greek culture more than was thought. That includes astronomy and astrology. On a closer look, it appears that this is true of the names of the zodiacal and near to zodiac constellations. Instead of Perseus, this constellation was called Old Man in Mesopotamia, and Orion was named the Shepherd of the Skies. Some constellations in the same regions of the starry sky were totally different. The northern part of Aquarius and half of Pegasus formed the constellation that was named Aswal Lo in Mesopotamia. Despite that Libra was formed in honor of Julius Caesar, Libra is a much older constellation. Since astrology primarily uses the constellations in the zodiac, we can tell that the names of the constellations connected moved from Mesopotamia to Greece without any great changes. The names of other constellations changed much more. At the end of the archaic period of Greek history, there was more astronomy and less astrology. The starry sky held an importance mainly for farmers and sailors. There was no astral religion in Greece and no sign of star cult. It is reasonably certain that astrological thinking has not evolved on the spot, but has been imported from Mesopotamia through Asia Minor and Egypt. The Greeks themselves assert that their astrology has Babylonian origins through many sources, and the most important of them is Chaldean Berossus of Beluza. Astrology elicited great interest in Greece, because compared to other future telling, it seemed more rational. This was probably one of the reasons why astrology underwent a revival, matching Mesopotamian and Greek constellations. Akkadian name, English translation, Greek name, modern name, Tud, Amy Rabutu, Great Twins, and B. Geminorum Alutu, Crab, a Cancer Ergulu, Lion, Leo Aru, King Regulus, a Leonis, Ir, U. Ayla, Cornea of Ayla, Speaker, Reverginus, Erec, Wagon, Ursa Major, Ericamer, Heaven's Wagon, Ursa Minor, Alu, the Bull of Heaven, Taurus Narahu, the Snake, Hydra Arabu, the Raven, the Crater, and Corvus Zibonitu, the Scales, Libra Eru, the Eagle, the Most of the Aquila, Nunu, Fish, Pisces Ostrinus, Eurydimu, Mad Dog, Lupus Plus, the Scorpi Zukakipu, the Scorpion, a Scorpio Suhermal, the Goatfish, Dollar, Capricornus. Astrological ideas influenced Zeno of Citium, the founder of Stoicism. According to Stoic philosophy, the human being is a microcosm, which is coherent with macrocosm. Greek poet Aratus, who has written two astronomical and two astrological poems, made those ideas widely known. Hellenistic tradition adopted astrology from Chaldea in 1st century BC. Even though there have been references to earlier Greek horoscopes as early as 72 BC, the first Greek horoscope written on papyrus dates back to 10 BC in Neugebauer. In the 3rd century BC, around the same time that Berossus taught in his own school of astrology on Kos Island, Aristarchus pondered on heliocentric cosmology, having previously demonstrated that the Sun is much bigger than the Earth. The astronomers Aristillus and Timaharis worked in the Great Library of Alexandria, surrounded by 500,000 manuscripts. Their results were used by Apollonius to create his theory of epicycles. Ancient scientists sought more for universal philosophical truths than for scientific facts in the modern-day sense. But astronomy was an exception. While natural sciences dealt with general principles, astronomy and astrology had the purpose of saving events. It meant that astrologers or astronomers had to be able to predict the time and place of star configurations, and had to know their possible consequences, bad or good. Astronomical predictions could be verified with observations, but astrological interpretation allowed astrologers to prevaricate. Even so, one must not overestimate the authority of astrology and astronomy. Astronomy was considered only to attend to saving events, while philosophers had to find the truth, which seemed more important to contemporary people. In the period of zodiacal astrology, it was a quite normal belief that terrestrial events happened due to celestial ones. It is very plausible that a confiding belief in causality is evoked by astrological influences. In contemporary science, we can observe a strong belief in causality, as in ancient philosophy. It is possible that one of the main principles of science emerged and developed under the astrology, with the emergence of critical thinking in Greek culture. Despite its seeming rationality, astrology became subject to criticism. The first known active critic of astrology was the philosopher Carnides. However, it appears that criticism ceased when Greece came under Roman rule in the same century. The Roman worldview was fairly uncritical and full of omens. Similarly worthy of attention is the faith in causalistic relationships in antique philosophy and science. Nobody asks, for example, what gives causality the right to be causalistic. As noted before, in the period of astral fatalism, omens were treated as phenomena that are observed by the wise, but which in themselves do not cause the predicted event. In the period of zodiacal astrology, it is highly possible that from there stems the causality that can be found in both antique philosophy and contemporary science. Thus it is possible that causality, one of the foundation stones of modern sciences, has emerged and developed under astrology. The importance of astrology in ancient times is best illustrated by the work of Claudius Ptolemy, who has been considered the most influential astronomer and astrologer of antiquity. Ptolemy lived and worked in Alexandria in the 2nd century AD. Although astronomy and astrology at that time were not used as separate terms, Ptolemy made a clear distinction between the two terms and wrote a separate book on each topic. His famous Almagest to the Power of One Mathematic Sun Taxage largely covers the contemporary understanding of astronomy and was the most influential book of astronomy in the 15th century. The author, however, considered it an astronomical introduction to the main book, the Astrological Tetrabiblos, or the four books a Claude on Telema on Mathematicage Tetrab Blonde Sunt Pounds UJ. Modern research has indicated that in Almagest Ptolemy relied on the works of Hipparchus, who had lived 3 centuries before him, which he then intentionally skewed to fit his purpose, often doctoring results and describing observations that could not have existed. It was all for the sake of the astrological truth that he attempted to describe in Tetrabiblos. While Ptolemy's astronomical and cosmological views are quite well known even today, we know far less of his work in astrology. There, as well as in astronomy, Ptolemy was a systemizer rather than an inventor. His work could be compared with that of Vettius Valens, but was far more comprehensive and gained more fame and prestige. Characteristically of this period, the text does not include references. Therefore, it is impossible to distinguish between the summary of previous studies and the author's own contribution. In Tetrabiblos, Ptolemy also attempts to maintain the scientific approach, trying to avoid lapses into mysticism. In the first book of Tetrabiblos, he observes astrology from the technical aspect, dividing it in two: universal astrology, astrogeography, and personal astrology, medical or horoscopic astrology. The second book deals with universal astrology, the third and fourth book with personal astrology. The two last books are divided in three parts, discussing A. the birth omens, B. the moment of birth, and C. what happens after birth. Ancient astrology has always been and still is the moral pillar of various pseudosciences. Astrology is the key to understanding the nature of pseudosciences, either for purposes of criticism or for seeking traces of rationality in them. The analysis of pseudosciences enables us to study human thought. Sometimes it would be practical to disregard the stereotype that scientific reasoning is the only way to acquire trustworthy information. More efficient definition of scientific conviction would provide new approaches in the critique of pseudosciences, and would enable the criticism of scientific ideologists for their vague evasion of pseudosciences, which paradoxically may lead to pseudoscientific tendencies in practical science. A closer look at the subject somewhat unexpectedly reveals that compared to other ancient practices, ancient astrology complies more closely with modern scientific requirements. Some important paradigms may in fact prove to originate in astrology. We should not condone the practice of separating the history of astronomy and the history of astrology, as it is not in accordance with the principle of scientific objectivity nor the convictions of the authors, as both Lynn Thorndike and Paul Feyerabend have warned. It appears that if we also took ancient astrology in consideration, the history of astronomy and of science in general would raise fewer question marks. The history of astronomy does not need to be revised, and the lack of censorship will certainly not deprive it of its scientific dignity.
This was brought to you by The Strange, The Bizarre, The Unusual, I Like It, on YouTube and Facebook. Listen to our podcast on any of these platforms: Anchor, Breaker, Overcast, Pocket Casts, Radio Public, Spotify. Support us on Patreon, and check us out on Discord. All the links can be found in the description below. We thank you for your participation. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, share, make comments. We love feedback.